Good morning. Good morning. On behalf of CSIS, Dr. John Hamry and Dr. Kath Hicks and the U.S. Naval Institute, we welcome you to the next installment in our Maritime Security Dialogue series. The entire series is funded with the generous sponsorship of Lockheed Martin. I'd like to recognize Rear Admiral Stan Bozen, who's here today, who is our key sponsor at Lockheed Martin. Thank you. Our moderator today is Admiral Joseph Prueher. Admiral Prueher is a 1964 graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy. His last command was as Commander-in-Chief Pacific, SINCPAC. I love the sound of that. He then served two presidents as ambassador to the People's Republic of China from 1999 to 2001. Foremost, a carrier-based attack pilot for his first 24 years of service, he also spent 3 years as a test pilot at Pax River. He has extensive flight and combat experience with over 5,600 flight hours and over 1,000 carrier landings. He was qualified in 52 different types of aircraft, held numerous senior operational commands, including two aircraft carrier wings, and led the formation of the Naval Strike Warfare Center at Fallon. Later, he was a group commander and commander 6th Fleet. We welcome Admiral Prueher as our moderator, and I'll go into the other, directly into the other introductions. Admiral Prueher, thank you for joining us here.
Thanks, Pete.
Lieutenant General John Davis is a Marine and a Naval aviator, and during his career, he's flown over 4,500 hours in the Aviate-B Harrier, the F-5, and the F-A-18, and is co-pilot in every type model series of aircraft in the Marine Corps inventory. He commanded VMA 223 and the 2nd Marine Air Wing. He also served as assistant air ops in the 3rd MAW in 2003 in Iraq for their drive up to Baghdad. Lieutenant General Davis served as deputy commander of the Joint Functional Component Command Network Warfare at Fort Meade and later came back as deputy commander U.S. Cyber Command. He has served as Deputy Commandant for Aviation, Headquarters Marine Corps, the leader of Marine Air since June 2014. Welcome.
Thank you.
Vice Admiral Mike Shoemaker is a 1982 graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy. And during his career, he's accumulated 4,400 flight hours, serving at 20 commands worldwide. He's commanded two fighter squadrons, a carrier air wing, two carrier strike groups, and served as the commander of Naval Air Forces Atlantic. He currently leads the entire Naval Aviation Force of the Navy, 10 deployable aircraft carriers and air wings, and more than 300 aviation commands. He served, or has served, in his current position as commander of Naval Air Force Pacific and as commander of Naval Air Forces U.S. Navy, the Air Boss, since January of this year. Let's give them all a big welcome.
Okay, the heavy lifting is done. Good morning, and it's great to be here with all of you today. It's a particular thank you to CSIS and to the Naval Institute for hosting this event. You might think from the introductions that the people up here knew what they were talking about, but we'll see how that goes. My role is just to keep the things moving, but Pete offered me the chance to say a few sentences, to use his words, of introduction to sort of set the stage here. So let me try a few of them on you. Lieutenant General Davis and Mike Shoemaker, Vice Admiral Mike Shoemaker, and Mike's shoulders are ones on which I rode for a couple of years in the past, but they are foremost, they're leaders, they're aviators, they're tacticians, and they are people of great experience and skill. Their charge now and the jobs that they have now is to have both the people and the machinery of naval aviation ready to go at any time. And these These missions are to support our nation's objectives as well as to support the troops on the ground. And it's a big job. They do this by having people trained and by having up aircraft. And these two things go together to give the capability to man our air wings and to man our carrier decks to respond in the world. So this is a big job that they have. In addition, they grapple with an acquisition system which is in the process of delivering an airplane that has been in the works for 2 decades in order to get here. The challenges with this airplane are not primarily technical ones, they are bureaucratic ones and systematic ones in the acquisition process, and they grapple with that as well. Current readiness is what they are about. So what Naval Aviation does, and what these guys are responsible for doing and for answering the bell each time, is to respond to crises in the world for the nation's objectives with tactical air power, and also to support troops and to have carrier air wings and aircraft carriers in place where rapid response is required or there are no land bases available. They are very able to do this, and they are, what you have here are two committed officers who are committed to the nation's well-being, and they are accountable and responsible for responding and answering the bell for naval aviation in the world. And they're going to tell you how they do it today. So I'll turn it over now to Mike Shoemaker.
Great. Well, thanks, Admiral. First off, I'd like to just thank CSIS for hosting today. It's great to be here, certainly with my counterpart on the Marine Corps side, Dog Davis. Admiral Daly, thanks for Naval Institute supporting this event. And boss, great to see you again. our time at SyncPAC was I traveled all over the AOR out there, and a great experience working with him and his wife, Suzanne, and I stood on his shoulders, not the other way around. So it's great to be here to talk about the future of naval aviation and Navy and Marine Corps aviation. And as you look around the world today, I'll start with the fact that our naval forces and our strike groups in particular remain in high demand. And that's across all of our combatant commanders. They all would like, I think, to see a little more carrier strike group presence. They clearly understand the value that those carriers and air wings and the surface forces that accompany that strike group provide in terms of an undeniable deterrent value, the persistent forward presence, the access they provide, and then the options they give them to respond to across the spectrum of threats, and then to provide, if needed, respond to natural disasters. Even in contested waters and airspace, our current air wing today can operate, with given the maneuverability of the strike group and the composition of that air wing, can operate in that environment. And so I'll talk about not so much today's air wing, but the future air wing, which is our focus today. First off, I'll give a lot of credit to one of my counterparts, my right-hand man in the Pentagon, Rear Admiral Mike Nasty Manazer, who is the guy that does all of our aviation programming requirements, and as Admiral Prueher talked about, works through that acquisition process to deliver those capabilities that I need, that I think the nation needs. And so he's been chartered to drive toward our Naval Aviation Vision 2025, which Admiral Buss, ahead of me as Air Boss, spent a lot of time working on last year, and that's a great document. And so as Nasty works that, he's been very, in a very tight environment, fiscal environment, and the challenges we have back there, been able to keep our type model series transitions on track. He's been able to deliver those integrated warfighting capabilities that I need, that the nation needs, and our strike group commanders need, in terms of the platforms, the payloads, the sensors, and the networks. And he's just done a superb job in that capacity and a very, very tough environment. So if you look ahead in our future air wing, we've transitioned out of legacy platforms and into what we'll have probably for the next decade plus in a few communities. First one is in our EA-6Bs. We've gone out of Prowlers. We did the sundown for the Prowlers last month. We're totally transitioned now to the EA-18G Growler, which will provide the electromagnetic spectrum dominance in our strike groups and air wings of the future. It'll provide advanced airborne electronic attack, the ability to screen and protect our strike group and joint forces, as well as support our joint forces on the ground. In the rotary world, our MH-60 Romeo and Sierra transitions are just about complete as well. We've got the last Foxtrot Hotel Squadron combination that's out on Teddy Roosevelt right now. When they come home, they'll transition. That'll complete a complete transition in that community from legacy platforms to the Romeo MH-60 Romeo and Sierra helicopters. The Romeo comes with a very capable anti-surface warfare and a submarine warfare package. It delivers. It's got an airborne low frequency sensor, an advanced periscope detection system on board, and you combine that with its data link, its radar, its forward-looking infrared radar, and its ability, a very capable electronic warfare suite. It is the inner defense zone against the submarine for the carrier strike commander. Pair that up with our MH-60 Sierras, again, designed to be anti-surface warfare platform, but just very complementary to the Romeo. Works closely with our special operating forces, provides our combat search and rescue for that for the air wing. Together, a very potent combination, and I got to watch them in action numerous times as a strike group commander as we transited the Strait of Hormuz and then operated in the North Arabian Gulf. In the airborne electronic AEW, our airborne early warning, we're transitioning right now from our E2Cs to E2Ds. We've got two squadrons transitioned, one just about to complete back in Oceania, or in Norfolk. One is deployed, the first is deployed right now in Teddy Roosevelt, VW-125. This brings, with its advanced radar, new electronically scanned radar, brings some incredible capabilities, significant improvements in the ability to search and track targets, and then also to command and control and coordinate the missions across the carrier strike group, whether it be integrated air missile defense, long-range anti-surface warfare, long-range anti-air warfare. It is essentially the quarterback for the strike group and comes with some very, very good capabilities in that delta. In the strike fighter world, as we phase out of our legacy platforms, we'll replace the legacy F-18C with our F-35Cs. And that's been a bit of a slow process, but one that we need to happen. And Admiral Menaz has worked very hard to ensure that we deliver the initial operating capability of that that platform will be this in 2018 when the first squadron stands up in Lemoore, and then we'll gradually stand up to have hopefully about half of our, one of those squadrons, each of our air wings, into the middle or so of the next decade. And so that's a capability that we need to get to the air wings right now. It comes with, obviously, with its stealth capabilities, ability to penetrate both air and surface threat envelopes. But probably the most important capability it brings is the ability to fuse information, collect the signals and things that are out in the environment there, fuse it all together, and deliver that fused picture to the rest of the strike group through the networking that we've got, we have designed there. So very critical to the integrated warfighting capabilities that will come in that future air wing. And also pass all that information, as I said, back to the E2, back to our other ships and decision makers in the strike group. Our Super Hornets right now will remain, they're the bulk of our air wings right now, well over three quarters of the air wing composition are Super Hornets. And they'll continue into the next decade and beyond. And they're the workhorses of the fleet. Ability to carry and deliver advanced both air-to-air and air-to-surface weapons, they'll be a perfect complement to the F-35 with a high-low mix of capability in that future air wing that I think will be very valuable. Triton, in one of our unmanned systems, So the last of the transitions will be into our unmanned systems. The first of those is a Fire Scout, which we've been flying now we've got almost 15,000 hours operating that platform off of our frigates in support of special operating forces off the coast of Africa, and then conducting counter-narcotics missions down off the coast of South America. So very proven platform. We'll integrate it with our Romeo and Sierras into our LCS, our littoral combat ships, or whatever the small combatant looks like in the future, with the integrated packages that go with that. And so that capability is being demonstrated right now forward in Singapore with a Romeo and a Fire Scout operating on Fort Worth. And they've been there on a third rotation in that very successful detachment. Additionally, in the unmanned world, we've got Triton, which will be essentially a follow-on from the Broad Area Maritime Surveillance demonstrator we've been operating in Fifth Fleet for the last few years. And we've got three of those air vehicles now. It will provide our joint force commanders and our fleet commanders with a persistent maritime ISR, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance capability designed to set up an orbit in each of our combatant command AORs which will give it a multi-sensor package that will be able to feed that information, fuse it, and provide it to those decision makers. It'll complement the P-8s that will eventually come online. Again, a very capable anti-submarine warfare platform that can do the entire anti-submarine warfare kill chain from initial detection all the way up to engagement. So a complementary asset, Triton will complement P-8. Lastly, in the unmanned world, will be the unmanned carrier-launched airborne surveillance and strike asset, UCLASS. Obviously going through some reviews right now in the building, and I think as a former strike group commander, where I see that platform's value is clearly in where it can operate inside those contested environments, provide the combatant commander, or more importantly, the strike group commander, information ahead of the strike group moving into there. Essentially, the eyes and ears of a carrier strike group commander as you move into that contested environment. Ability to conduct integrated targeting and ID capability, feed that information again back through the networks to the strike group. And you put it all together in our advanced Ford class carriers, which will deliver in the spring of 2016. I think that will be the nucleus of our future carrier strike group. So a very capable air wing paired up with that platform. Very critical enabler of U.S. power projection well into the 21st century. Again, Admiral Manazer's talked at length about the value of that platform. I'll hold off. We want to talk a little more about Ford later, but suffice to say that I think when you put that air wing in the future together with Ford, we've got a very, very capable, lethal combination that can sail and operate in contested waters and airspace around the world. Lastly, I think Admiral Prueher mentioned the current readiness challenges that we have, and General Davis will talk to this as well. As a type commander, that's my responsibility, is to ensure that force going forward is man trained and equipped for success. And we're challenged right now in that current environment. It comes from about a decade plus, 14 years or so of sustained combat operations, and it's taken its toll on the force. And we're looking now to reset and recapitalize a bit. And that our optimized fleet response plan, which Fleet Forces has developed, we're just in the throes of getting into the final implementation of that plan. And I think that'll give us an opportunity to provide those windows where we can get our carry maintenance and maintenance done on our aircraft, as well as predictable deployment lengths inside of a 36-month cycle. And so I think as we move into that OFRP plan, it'll give us the regular deployments that CNOs talked about, our sailors are looking for, and then the predictability for them, and also the ability to surge outside of those deployment windows. And I think that will allow us to focus on that reset and recapitalization. So I'm looking forward to delivering that capability. So wrap up, I couldn't be more proud of what our sailors are doing around the world right now at sea and ashore as they represent the United States Navy and represent the nation. So thank you.
Thanks, Shu. Doug,
hey, sir, thanks. Over to you. Thanks, sir. Shu, thanks for being such a good teammate. Good morning, everybody. It's a real honor to be here. I know a lot of the faces in the crowd. And thanks for all you do to keep our nation safe, to keep defense at the top of everybody's interest out there. Thanks to our foreign partners for being out here. We couldn't do it without you. I'm a very proud naval officer. One of the first in my family, and now my family's got a lot of Marines and sailors associated with it. But I'm also a very proud Marine. United States Marine Corps exists for one purpose, that's to be the nation's force in readiness, ready to deploy and move out at a moment's notice and fight our nation's battles wherever they may fall, right, against any foe in any clime, any place. So, coin of my realm, the sole reason I exist is to provide General Dunford and my Marine Corps with ready aircraft, ready crews, ready to go take that fight to the enemy, from sea bases and shore bases, expeditionary bases ashore. The Marine Corps has unique gear that allows us to flow from a sea base and flow ashore and back again. It's an imperative that our gear can do that equally well. So unique allows it extreme agility, but also looking for the combat power out there to strike that blow when need be. And also, too, as General Mattis used to say, no worse enemy, we're focused on that, the warfighting capabilities, but also, too, no better friend. Okay, when the problems happen out there in the world, the natural disasters, you want Marine and Navy forces offshore ready to come ashore, and we take great pride in being able to do that. If you can move men and material ashore to provide combat power, you can also provide the food and the logistics that people need to sustain themselves in their darkest hour. I'll tell you, I've got a couple of main focuses, and I think Admiral Prueher, you said it the best. It's about machines, but really, I invert that. It's actually more about the people. Number one thing is we're going to equip the man, not man the equipment. And we're going to give our Marines the very best tools to go take the fight to the enemy and do what they've got to do. So for me, if my number one job is readiness, I've got some challenges out there. I'll talk about that, just as Shu had talked about in the current readiness realm. But three main jobs for the Deputy Commandant for Aviation. One, the building the future force, future combat capability, and for the Marine Corps, recapitalizing the entire fleet of Marine aircraft. We're in the process of doing that. We're about halfway through a process we started before 9/11, 2001, right? So we're about halfway through. We're executing the plan we started back in the late 90s. We're executing that plan now. And we've been doing that, oh, by the way, while we've been engaged in 14 years of conflict, all right, in combat, hard combat. And to a large degree, the United States Marine Corps is still forward deployed and still out there and still fighting. Our deployment to dwell ratios are still very, very low, which is a bad thing. We're still good if you want to be busy, bad if you're trying to recapitalize and reset the force. We are out there and forward deployed. Many of our TAC air units are at 1-2 dwell. That's right at the razor's edge of not being able to train the next wave, getting ready to go. Very, very busy. So building the future force, recapitalizing. I'll talk about the platforms we're doing that with. The other one is current readiness. Future readiness, new stuff. Current readiness is the current stuff. Being Marines, being good stewards of taxpayers' dollar, trying to extract maximum utility and maximum value out of everything we own. I'll tell you, we're not doing a very good job of that right now. And that's got taking a lot of my brain cells right now. How we extract maximum value out of all the gear that we have and provide maximum readiness to that gear. We have very, very good combat proven equipment. It is old, but it is good. Okay, properly maintained, we can still get more life out of that. We're going to extract every ounce of life out of those platforms, every ounce of combat capability to fight the battles that win our nation's battle until we can transition anew. We'll be very proud to turn those airplanes into the boneyard when we're done with that, and they'll be good airplanes at the height of their combat capability as we transition to the new stuff, because the threats that loom in our bow require the new gear. Last but not least is what we call basically connecting the Marine Air Ground Task Force. So we're buying very high-end gear. We want to connect that to the most potent warfighting asset in the battlefield, which is the Marine Lance Corporal at the pointy end of the spear. So taking systems and the sensors and the capabilities I have in my aviation component and pushing that down to the man on the ground, the Marine on the ground. Because at the end of the day, the Marine Corps fights as this Marine Air Ground Task Force. We do pretty well fighting joint. We take great pride in that, joint and combined. But we are kind of designed for fit function to be in a Marine Air Ground Task Force. That's the way we've been trained from the day we come in the Marine Corps. It's how we process data. It's how we plan. And I think it provides that extra combat agility and combat capability in the battlefield that gives us kind of our own little mini joint force in a microcosm. We say so. We've got our future gear that we're buying, the current gear that we're going to maintain and sustain, and we're going to connect that. In many ways, we are moving out of the single mission platform. So how do you extract maximum utility out of everything you have? You make everything multi-mission. Everything multi-mission. Every platform a sensor, every platform a sharer, every platform a shooter. What am I talking about? We took a C-130J and we made it into an airplane called Harvest Hawk. Okay, it was very difficult to get it through the hill, but they approved that. But half the airplane is an air refueler, the other half of the airplane is a weapons platform. So I can pass gas and shoot, not at the same time, but in the same mission. I'm out there, and we use that to great effect in Iraq and Afghanistan. We had a relatively low threat environment over the battlefield in Iraq and Afghanistan. With Harvest Hawk, we could have a tanker that's up there passing gas. Could also have an airplane up there with a sensor that could do convoy escort, overwatch the roads, but also too with small yield precision weapons that our crews were trained to use and employ with great effect. Going to put an air refueling package in a V-22 called VARS. Why would you do that? Because we need it to have it. An airplane can do that. Putting a air refueling capability in a V-22 that allows us to pass 10,000 pounds of gas to a strikers or helicopters or tilt rotors or whoever is a tremendous combat capability. We have put assets on board these Marine Expeditionary Units. The V-22 probably is the airplane that is the most in-demand airplane in the Department of Defense today. We We're producing them off the production line pretty quickly. We can't train the crews fast enough to go man them and sustain them at the rates we need to. But putting a V-22 on an amphibious ship or on a expeditionary base ashore, replacing a helicopter, the CH-46, which we just retired about a week ago down at the Udall-Hazy Museum. But that airplane had a combat radius of about 50 nautical miles from a ship, from a sea base, maybe about 75. Replacing that with an airplane that goes 450 miles without air refueling, combat radius, that routinely flies 2,000 miles across the ocean, okay? Like it's no big deal, right? What happens, an airplane for 50-mile transit doing about 100 miles an hour, 110 miles an hour, that's X number of minutes, that's about 30 minutes. Not a lot changes in the battlefield in 30-minute transit. A lot can happen in 450 miles, even doing 280 knots indicated. A lot can happen in 2,000 miles, an eight-hour transit. So the guys in the back of the airplane, again, we talked about that Lance Corporal that's the most important guy out there in the battlefield. Getting that Lance Corporal, his platoon commander, his squad leader, the information they need to keep up with a changing environment has actually driven change in the Marine Corps. So we've got this disruptive technology of V-22 now giving the information to the guys in the back. How do you do that? Requires more comm gear, more thought goes into how we push information to the guy in the back of that airplane, and more importantly, because the customer is not a guy you push stuff to, the guy he pulls stuff from. He's the Google generation. That Marine, he or she pulls stuff from the information. So they want to be able to pull the information they want, tailor the information they want, and bring it out of that airplane. And we're doing that right now in 15th Marine Expeditionary Unit. We've been doing it for about the last five or six WTI classes with our infantry officer class. We do long-range raids in both CH-53s and V-22s with a package we call digital interoperability in the back of the airplane. We're pushing streaming video from AVH, F-18s, from UAS into the back of that airplane out there, and we're achieving great success with that. And again, we're employing that operationally right now in 15th MU. So V-22 has changed the battle space for us in many, many ways, many positive ways, but also it forced us to rethink how we're doing business. Bottom line is we replaced the CH-46 with the V-22, and again, that disruptive technology out there has really changed the way that we look at our Marine Expeditionary Unit. The Marine Expeditionary Unit, days gone by, is no longer the Marine Expeditionary Unit today. Disaggregated ops is absolutely enabled by an airplane like that. Command and control is challenged when you push a Marine Expeditionary Unit, the ARG, the Amphibious Ready Group, and spread it out over 2,000 miles where one ship's off the north coast of Africa and the other ships are in the Persian Gulf. And they connect that with C-130s and B-22s, okay, under one MU commander. We do that routinely. We had forces in Afghanistan, forces off the shore of Africa, and forces in the Mediterranean, and one Marine Expeditionary Unit a few years back. Really phenomenal capability. We are going to replace our CH-53 Echo with a CH-53 Kilo. We are about 60% through our transition from the AH-1 Whiskey and the UH-1 November to the AH-1 Zulu and the UH-1 Yankee. Step change, increases in capability, great airplanes out there coming into the fleet. The AV-8, the F-18, and the Prowler are all in the process of transitioning right now to the F-35. We just stood up our first F-35B squadron, VMFA 121 in Yuma, Arizona. The next one will be VMFA 211, and we already have our training squadron, which is basically a mixed bag of Brits and U.S. Marines down there in Beaufort, North Carolina, or South Carolina. Train to fly the F-35B right now. The F-35 for us is that fifth generation platform that is going to change the battlefield much like the V-22 has changed us. Bottom line, giving us access to the contested battle space that we've not had access to before. It will absolutely positively change the Marine Expeditionary Unit and the way they view the amphibious forces based at sea and our expeditionary forces in a way that I think is yet to be defined, but I think will be, for our adversaries, will be quite worrisome. For us, should be a great source of great comfort. That aircraft, the F-35, is an airplane actually can go from fifth generation to fourth generation. And what do I mean by that? No other airplane can go from fifth to fourth and back to fifth again. I'm buying pylons for the airplane. I get the pylons in 3F software, which comes in 2017. I can load up an F-35B with about 3,000 pounds more ordnance than I can put on an F-18 right now, right? So I can have an airplane that does fifth generation stuff, for the opening salvo, the fight. When I have to go to level of effort, I can load the pylons on, load ordnance on there, do level of effort, come back, sail to another part of the world, take the pylons off, and go do the fifth generation thing again. That gives, we talked about multi-mission airplanes, but also multiple layers of capability in those platforms as well. It's still a new platform. We're still growing into it. But it offers us tremendous utility for Marine Corps that's going to have one type model series aircraft, the ability to go fourth and fifth gen, give us that fighter capability, give us that attack capability that we need in the out years. And bottom line, BMFA 121 just did an operational readiness inspection to get them ready to convince us that they are actually indeed ready to go be declared initial operational and capable. And I did a fantastic job in the interdiction mission we had them do, and the offensive counter air, the offensive counter air, the close air support, and the armed reconnaissance. It's really interesting. I won't give you the exchange rate on the defensive counter air, but it was really good. Zero losses, and there's a bunch of bad guys that would constructively wouldn't be sortied again. And the armed reconnaissance one was the most interesting one. We gave them a really high-end threat environment to go against. And normally, to go do close air support or armed reconnaissance, you want to be able to get into kind of a low threat environment to go up there and look for targets. And guys nodding their heads who have done that before, we gave them a high threat environment, okay, to go out there and basically do armed reconnaissance. Go out there, troll, looking for force structure targets in a battlefield out there using the sensors they had on the airplane. And we gave them difficult targets to find. And we also gave them a difficult threat, which in my world as the CO of the weapons school would be a prohibitive threat. They went out there, they found those targets, they dealt with that, and they came back, they said, hey, we did it as a four ship. I'm sure no one ever asked us to do this again, but we did it, we survived the threat, we found the targets, we killed the targets. I said, don't ever rule out, you have a capability, don't ever rule out what someone's gonna ask you to go do, right? Don't rule out, you never take away a capability from the adversary, and certainly we never wanna take away a capability, something we've got available to us, so. On the F-35, so not without its challenges, but bottom line is we are absolutely convinced we're in the right spot, we're going the right direction, and now for us it's about equipping the men and the women that are going to fly that airplane with the right power tools. On the people side of it, we always talk about the guys wiggling the stick, doing the flying, doing the fighting, or doing working a sensor for one of our UAS. Let's not forget the folks that maintain that. I'm going to talk to you about some of my challenges in current readiness. Okay, it's not just aging platforms and lack of spares and depots that aren't producing airplanes at the rate they are. It's also retaining and training and keeping the right enlisted force out there to keep those guys working on the airplanes and with the skill sets they need to generate the readiness we need. I'd say if there's one thing that we haven't done as a Marine Corps, General Dunford talks about all the time, it's focused on the leader to lead in the barn for our aviation platforms and making sure that our guys have the right training continuum, the recurrent training out there, and valuing the guys with the qualifications. You know, we wear patches, WTI, Top Gun, we covet that, that's really cool. What's really cool to me right now is readiness, and how I get readiness is not only having a full up parts bin, but also to having a very competent, experienced maintainer to come out that knows exactly what they need to do, that are trained, that are well led from the Lance Corporal all the way up to the Gunnery Sergeant in my barn, in my aviation maintenance hangars, and we are working really hard to make sure that once we get them, we identify them, we keep them, we train them, we retain them. That's a strategic imperative for the Marine Corps, and General Dunford, our Commandant, is all over that. Retain the aviators as well, the pilots, and the air command and controllers, and our weapon systems officers that do this job is really imperative as well. So it's not just about the power tools, it's about the aircraft. Now, a lot of people, we talk about the sea-based. I'll tell you that for the United States Marine Corps, everything we do is can flow from a sea-based. Our future will be, everything will be sea-baseable. But about two-thirds of our combat power is land-based expeditionary. Okay, and that's for our plans, for the big plans that we have to go support our nation. We go from a sea-base ashore back to sea-base again, but a lot of that's ashore. So right now, I say I've got actually more airplanes deployed ashore in expeditionary environments than I do afloat, right? So afloat, ashore, that's the utility of the Marine Corps. That's what we're working on, a force and readiness. I'll tell you that our current readiness challenges, I'll cap with it, is the not so good story. We have way too many airplanes that we can't employ the way we need to. We can't generate the readiness we need to. And bottom line, we have to turn that around. Admiral Shoemaker and I spent all day yesterday at Navy Supply, 2 weeks ago, is all day down at Defense Logistics Agency, I've been on the Hill. I've been to talk to everybody. It's been in the press. It's no real surprise that we are not where we need to be as a force in readiness, the United States Marine Corps, and aviation readiness. That is my problem. It's my responsibility, and it's mine to fix. I am accountable to fix that. We have a strategy to do that, okay? We've had two outside looks in at Marine Aviation, two of our type model series. We're getting ready to start the third. They tell me I can achieve my readiness goals, just not the way I'm doing it right now. So we are taking those lessons learned. We're basically driving that home. We're going to drive change in the way we do business, okay? And part of that's funding. Part of that's the human capital side of it. But also, too, it's how we operate and how we sustain. And bottom line is that's the, to me, at the end of the day, the history books will not remember that the F-35 was a little bit late to need, right? That there's maybe some dysfunction out there in the different zip codes out there in and around this town. The only thing the history books will care about is were we, Shu and I, and our naval air forces, ready to go on game day, yes or no? That's all they're going to care about.
Thank you.
We choose ready.
Yep. Thanks very much. That's a couple of information-rich presentations, and thank you both very much. What we're going to do is do some questions and answers here. We'll do them as long as you want until 10 o'clock, whichever comes first. And I had a couple of warm-up questions, but I think I'm going to forego mine. And if we get a lull, I may squeeze them in. But in the meantime, yes, back there, sir.
Yes, sir. Britt Mitchell, Renaissance Institute, Baltimore. Pastor Britt, actually. My question is this. I wouldn't have come today except that on NPR last Saturday morning, they had a story on from a Naval Air Development facility somewhere talking about how they had developed drones that are not just drones like normal drones, but they send them up in either batches of 24 or 32, and the drones themselves pick their own leader, and I assume pick the mission. And it scared me to death. So bad I got out of the shower and wrote on a paper towel to come here today. great report, but could you touch on that? Is that really viable?
That's an information-rich question we have. Would either of you like to field that?
I would say that unmanned air systems, unmanned systems, both air and ground and sea, are a big part of the naval forces' future. I don't know of any. I'm not working on a swarming drone project right now.
Yeah.
But I do think that we're going to integrate manned and unmanned with everything we do, right? And bottom line is, at the end of the day, you're going to hold senior leaders accountable for how this both the manned and unmanned platforms are used. And bottom line is, I think we will do everything. We're going to do everything the right way. We're not. I haven't seen, but artificial intelligence. I think there is probably a future out there for platforms to be self-organized and self-thinking, but I don't have anything in the works right now on that.
Yeah. Okay, over there.
Hi, Kevin Wensing. Two questions. One on V-22. How do you see the export potential for V-22 with our allies? And the second question, are we building enough amphibious assault ships and so forth to carry the Marine Corps, aviation expeditionary forces? Thanks.
I think the tilt rotor technology has tremendous potential. We already have foreign partners that are ordering the airplane and more to follow. I think we, like all our stuff, we need to drive cost out and reliability in. And I think that's probably the coin of the realm for V-22. It's a great airplane. And I think probably more to follow on that. I think it's people have seen the utility of that. And yes, we need more amphibious ships.
And we're actually taking a page from the Marine playbook as we transition from our venerable C2 Greyhounds that are doing our carry on board delivery right now. And we'll use bring the CV-22 into the carry environment as our logistics connector for the strike groups of the future. And then given all the things that General Davis talked about, flexibility of that platform gives us an options to do other things as well with it. When you talk about the support to the Marines in terms of amphibious ships, that's one we continue to work inside the building, and from my counterpart, Admiral Roden, who's the surface warfare or surface warfare boss, or Sea Lord, we call him, is obviously working that inside the budget. A challenging environment, but we're working to do what we can to support the Marines with the ships they need.
We'll move to this side. Yes, sir. Here he comes.
Good morning, gentlemen. Otto Kreischer with Sea Power Magazine. Both of you have touched on the need for sensors reconnaissance. Could you kind of elaborate on that, how you're integrating your systems? The big problem we're going to have in the A2AD environment is getting information so the strike groups can go in safely. Talk about how your platforms that you're building are going to integrate that, the sensor information, so you can have the ISR picture you need.
Right. Well, I touched on that a little bit when I described UCLASS and how Navy envisions employing that. As you said, that would be, I think, our initial platform that would go into that contested environment, that A2AD environment you just described. Certainly ahead of Triton or Poseidon, you know, our P-8s. They couldn't operate in there without the initial kind of understanding of that environment, which that UCLASS will provide. And then also the ability to operate there, to be able to conduct, you know, provide an integrated picture and targeting of assets. And also, if needed, it can do the time-critical strike or quick reaction strike capability will come with that as part of the platform. So I think that's a critical piece, at least from the strike group perspective. There are other assets we'll potentially use to, you know, from a theater that'll be theater controlled, or the joint air component commander may control, but that's one that I know we need at the strike group level, controlled by the strike group commander, to operate with the strike group and ahead of the strike group into that environment.
If I could just, we need to make sure that all the forces at sea are integrated into that picture. I think it's actually leveraging everything that's out there. Go back to every platform, a sensor, share, shooter. So when I say platform, it's manned, it's unmanned, it's cyber capabilities, it's space capabilities, it's everything that we have. I think fifth generation assets allow you to get a little bit closer, see a little bit more. Our big challenge, frankly, right now with the fifth gen platforms we have, like an F-35, is how do I, that airplane is a pretty smart player. How do I leverage everything that's on that player and get it back to the guy on the ground or whoever else needs that information in a bandwidth and a flow rate that they can use and share that? So, and to include how we share that with coalition partners that are out there. So I think it's a challenge, but it's also an opportunity.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Lee Hudson, Inside the Navy. Admiral Shoemaker, could you give us some insight into what you think the aviation mix should be for the future frigate? Will it be the same as LCS, or do you see it being different?
Can you say that again? I didn't.
The aviation mix for the future frigate, or the modified LCS, whatever you want to call it. The
Oh, for the new surface combatant? Yeah, surface combatant.
Right, sure.
I'm not sure of the design. Again, that kind of falls in my counterpart's lane, the Sea Lord I just talked about, but I know that we are prepared and have our acquisition programs, and the future of our MH-60 Romeo and Sierra program includes integrations into whatever that platform may be.
LCS, right, because you mentioned Fire Scout as well.
Right, and so. Fire Scout as well.
Right, yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Bill Sweetman with Aviation Week. Talking about the need to slap and extend the life of Super Hornets, the problems with readiness, the problems we've had with the classic Hornet. A couple of questions. One is it correct that the Department of Navy plans to bring in F-35C at a rate of slightly less than one squadron per year in the 2020s. I've heard things about a production rate of perhaps 12 F-35Cs a year. Mm-hmm. The next part of that question is, that leaves us, it appears, very dependent on being able to slap the Super Hornets at a very high rate. And how are we going to make sure that we avoid the problems we've had with the classic Hornet slap, which I think, as we well know, has not gone as planned? A lot more things were found in those airframes than we expected. So how do you avoid that trap? How do you keep those problems, guarantee those squadrons are going to be full in the 2020s? Thanks.
Yeah, that's a great question. I knew it was coming. I see our little chiclet chart sitting next to you there, a PowerPoint slide that Admiral Manazer and I both use as we describe this.
Did everybody hear the question? Okay.
Yeah, so we're in this situation for a number of reasons. We've, you know, we've delayed the initial introduction of the F-35C from the Navy side. In fact, it's about almost 7 years when we planned to IOC that capability. And so that forced us to keep our classic Hornets, I like that term, our partners use that term, the classic Hornets around a lot longer. So a 6,000-hour airframe that we had to extend to 8,000 or 9,000 hours to keep it in the fight. And that was, and that's a pretty significant engineering feat to do that. So we didn't plan the, you described the Rhino SLEP, or Service Life Extension Program, we didn't plan it well for the Hornets, but we're working through that right now in our aviation depots. And the utilization, as both of us have talked about, the utilization of the force over the last decade plus, and so the hours we put on those classic Hornets quickly drove them to those 8,000, 9,000 hour limits and forced us to induct them, you know, earlier than we expected. So we got a bit of a backlog at our depots. We've got, I think the capacity there is improving at the depots. We've learned a lot about how we do the throughput there, as we've repaired those classic Hornets, it will apply to the SLEP program for our Rhinos. So I think this is not a problem we've solved. I mean, General Davis has a significant portion of his strike fighters are F-18s, them and the Harriers. But we've got to keep his legacy Hornets or classic Hornets in service for about another 10 or 12 years. And we've got a few less in the Navy, but we're doing the same thing. So the problem is getting through the Super Hornet SLEP, which would be in the middle of 2020 to 2025 or so, with the things we've learned from, applying those things we've learned from the classic Hornet maintenance work. And I think we've got a pretty good plan right now to move forward and avoid, a significant reduction or gap in our strike fighter inventory as those airplanes come out of service to get repaired and then get back into service. So it's not an inconsequential challenge we have ahead of us, and one we, General Davis and I, stay focused on a lot.
Part of the how we transition to talk about the Marine Corps side of that, which you have to take care of the Harrier and the classic F-18 in order to make your transition F-35. So it's a strategic imperative for the Marine Corps to take good care of these airplanes. I will brag a little bit on Admiral L.J. Sewell, who runs our commander of Fleet Readiness Center, is doing a great job and basically come up with a plan to rework our F-18s, both classic and the SLEP for the Supers, and gives us reason to believe. Actually, I don't do hope. I look for the numbers, and we're actually making the numbers in our depots now that we're supposed to. Again, with help from an OEM, we have Boeing working a third line to help us make the numbers we need to get the airplanes back in the line. One of the things we're going to do, Congress is very good, gave us six F-35Bs to replace our Bastion losses, and that allows us to stand down an F-18 squadron, BMF A-122 a little bit early, about a year early, and stand up as an F-35B squadron. So part of the way we reduce the pressure on the Don with classic F-18 is by the Marine Corps moving out of the F-18. Right now, scheduled the reserves shutting down in 2030. But the sooner we can do that, if we were to get more airplanes, we'd actually be able to move out of the classics a little bit earlier and sooner in F-35. So have to take care of the old in order to get to the new, sir.
And the F-35.
Yep, I was going to touch on that. You mentioned, I think the chart there probably has, there's a couple assumptions, one that delivers 12 per year and one at 20 per year. That's 20 per year is where we had hoped to be. I think the current realities of the budget environment and other priorities inside Navy may drive something between those two numbers, but obviously we're still on path to IOC this capability with our first squadron in 2018, and I'll keep working as hard as I can with our leadership in the building to ensure we can stay on the path and get out of classic Hornets, replace them with our F-35Cs as quick as we can.
Okay, over here.
Morning, gentlemen. Airboss, sir, this question's for you. It's a personnel leadership question. Recently wrote an article in Proceedings about CAG and who we select as CAG.
Yeah.
We haven't had a non-VFA CAG selectee in 5 years. This leaves out roughly half the air wing in the experience and leadership capability that brings with it. It also limits the career progression of more than half of your junior and mid-level officers, mm-hmm. and directly impacts retention of some quality personnel. I'm wondering, what are we doing to make sure that, A, we don't go another 5 years without selecting a non-VFA CAG, and how can we ensure that this leadership position better reflects the composition of the carrier airline? Thank you.
Yeah, great question. Is that your article?
Yes.
That was well written.
Thanks.
I read it this morning. I was over with CNP. Bill Moran, he said, you might want to read this before you go over to the...
Nice.
But well done. And as you know, he's on a big talent management push right now. And he's doing some wonderful things. Yeah. And I agree completely with your article. I look across our carrier force, the force of the future I just described, and I look at the leaders or the aviators that are flying in Growler, that are flying in our E-2Ds, that command and control that joint fight, and the situation awareness they have and the understanding of the missions across the strike warfare commander's responsibilities, to even include our helicopter squadron COs. I got this question twice now at both of our National Helicopter Association events, East and West Coast, and we had a, and I don't think it'll be too long before we find the right helicopter CO who's come up through the ranks and is fully capable of leading an air wing. They're integrated right now in many of the events we do. I talked about Strait of Hormuz transits when I was on a couple of strike groups there. They lead those events. All of the self-defense of the carrier involve those guys as strike leads. They're integrated with their fighter counterparts so that they understand kind of the full portfolio of what an air wing commander would need to do. So I think we're, and all it takes is a little bit of, as we put language and precepts for statutory boards, language and precepts for administrative boards. I control those, and I intend to take your recommendations and move forward with them. Yeah, nice article.
Okay. On the aisle.
Good morning, gentlemen. I'm Dan Grazier from the Center for Defense Information, and General, this question's for you. You mentioned multi-mission platforms, which results in multi-mission people.
Yes.
And then you also mentioned the 1-2 dwell issue and how difficult it is to then train people. How do you find that balance where you can train people in multiple missions with such limited time in which to train?
First off, we need to get more time training. So it's one of the things we laid out there. I'm a firm believer that employing and leveraging simulation. But I'm also a firm believer that a pilot or an air crew has to have 15 hours a month in an airplane, no less than that. So we drive our systems to make sure that we can do that. And our TNR manuals, training readiness manuals, support that. I will say that I might not be as multi-mission as my two sons are, right? They're a lot more multi-mission than me, and my eldest son's two daughters will probably be a heck of a lot more multi-mission than him when they finally come around to go do this. I would say that you look at the way that people multitask, and they operate things right now. I remember when I wrote a master's thesis on urban close air support in 1994. And I remember people saying, hey, that's a helicopter mission, just too hard to do for a jet. I said, things are moving too fast for a jet guy to do CAS in an urban environment. I said, it might be for us, because I was a major, I was really old then, I'm a major, but don't tell that to the captains, And so look at, that was what our brains thought in 1994, too much going on for a jet guy to do CAS in an urban environment. Now they're doing it like it's cool. Now we're doing it with UAS. Bottom line, things change. So I think the more equip the man, don't man the equipment. So give these kids the tools, they'll water your eyes. The V-22, we had a bunch of old guys thinking about how we're gonna use it. We turn it over to the young guys, they're using it completely differently. The demand signal for the comms is not coming from me, it's coming from the customer in the back of the airplane. Like, I can't ride for 8 hours and go into a hot LZ, I gotta have the couch. So I think we'll man the equipment. All right, we'll equip the man, not man the equipment. We'll basically push the information to these guys. I gotta make sure that we deliver the training systems that give them the minimum amount of actual flight training out there. And then leveraging simulators, a lot of times our simulator construct is onesies or twosies, or one guy in a box with an instructor. I've seen things where entire units go to a simulator to train. Unit training, pre-deployment training in a simulator. I think there's a lot more we can do to leverage to make sure that when that kid does get into that airplane, that he's ready for the A-ticket ride, not to do discovery learning once he gets in that he or she gets in that airplane.
Back here.
General Airboss, good morning. Mediox, I'm full disclosure, I'm one of your Growler guys, sir. The Naval Service leads and Naval Aviation in particular, both in the Navy and Marine Corps, lead the joint force in the spectrum in electromagnetic maneuver warfare as you've been developing for quite some time now, sir. I'm curious though, do you see a need for any structural changes either from a man train equip standpoint or operationally, either in the Department of the Navy or the, across the joint force, or even in the interagency and our allies and partners, to ensure that we truly can develop EMW into something where we have unity of effort in the spectrum, in a domain that is necessarily joint, contested, combined, that's probably the part of the global commons that is more key to military operations and all aspects of civil life than we even recognize today. I can tell you, as a growler guy, we in the last couple years of operating that aircraft and the new platform forward, we often show up as the smartest guy in the room and have to kind of point out how, you know, both the military plan and the greater Paul Mill context that we operate in or plan to operate in isn't set for success in a kill chain versus kill chain fight against adversaries where we don't have overmatch anymore.
Mm-hmm. Curious, I couldn't have said it any better. Yeah. No, but we're actually doing all of that. In fact, your community is leading our integration to electromagnetic maneuver warfare, certainly for aviation. Not that they're the only platform that would participate. Certainly as we deliver F-35, that comes with some very, very good electronic warfare capabilities. But we're just scratching the surface on what Growler can do, and I think, and how they integrate. They've been up and doing some of our exercises with Air Force counterparts up in Alaska, Northern Edge, and then down at Nellis as part of Red Flags down there. And the guys that are going, the squadron participating there are, I think, are opening some eyes and the capabilities of that platform. So we've got to keep that at the forefront as we move forward in this EMW world, and certainly use that expertise across all naval aviation, in fact, across the joint force.
If I could just, I got the rare honor of serving 4.5 years up at Fort Meade as a guy who failed college math. And bottom line is, I think it's going to be a complete team ball. And I think you need to have everybody in the fight. We used to call the non-kinetic fires are just as important as the kinetic, but it requires a lot of thought, a lot of planning. Just like you say, structural changes to make sure we do that right. Training changes to make sure we do the things right. I'd also say that it's kind of like not having race, not having electronic warfare. You have to have electronic warfare, and I think it needs to be almost ubiquitous. You need to have that. Every platform I've got out there, I'm trying to strap something on that airplane that gives it an EW capability, both high threat, low threat. My guys on the ground, my trucks, my airplanes, my ships, everything that we've got out there, we're trying to get that kind of capability. To include, if you go out to the weapons school, you've got Mark 4 Cyber out there playing to help us out in basically some of those scenarios. So I think, bottom line, this is requires a lot of thought. Our manned and unmanned systems are going to be key players in this. The unmanned systems have to have the dwell, the range, and the payload to be able to, and the comm links to be able to be contributors there. And also, by the way, survivable as well, so that they can't get knocked down in a contested environment.
For those of you that are on a tight schedule, it's a couple minutes after 10, but we're going to shift to Central Daylight Time for about 5 or 10 minutes here. So you get. Right behind you.
Sir, George Nicholson is an analyst for special operations. 2 weeks ago, they had the Directed Energy Summit that Secretary Kendall, Secretary Mabus attended. The commander of the Air Force Special Operations Command, Lieutenant General Brad Heidholt, got up and said one of his highest requirements right now is directed energy, putting that on the new AC-130 Ghost Rider gunship to give it a full comprehensive offensive and defensive capability. And he made the statement of, in our Block 60, it's supposed to be 10 years out. I'm telling you right now, it's only a couple of years out that we're going to have that. From your perspective, General Davis, your KC-130Js with that kind of capability of putting on it, but Admiral also the capability on Navy aircraft. When Secretary Mabus was asked the question, he said, well, our focus isn't on that. All we're worried about directed energy right now is a ground capability. Your comments.
Yeah. If I could real quickly, it's one, I'm embarrassed I missed that conference. So I actually kind of had a religious moment with my guys, like, how the heck did I know about that? I would have been there. Because that's actually, we're a big part of our LAD follow-on is directed energy, how you do that. We think it's got tremendous capability, tremendous potential. A lot of it's about weight. So right now, some of the systems are pretty heavy. So I can get up in a C-130, but I'd like to go get up in everything I own, right? And so hauling around a 3,000-pound tray might be a bit much for some of my platforms. So more and more, I think we're going to push the edge of the envelope in that to try to get that capability on land and in the air, probably at sea as well. But absolutely, it's part of the quiver in our future.
Yeah, my surface counterpart obviously is working very hard to deliver that capability to his ships. And we look at And I talked about a little bit about Ford and its ability to generate, you know, electrical generating capacity about 3.5 times what an Nimitz class brings. So clearly we can incorporate that technology as part of self-defense or even offensive manner on that, on Ford. As General Davis said, we've got to figure out, the smart guys in the room and engineers, to figure out how we can miniaturize this stuff to make it applicable to aviation platforms. But I, you know, as opposed to firing very expensive air-to-air, air-to-surface weapons, if we could do, you know, those kinds of directed energy, that I think that's a clear an area we got to keep focused and keep working in.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Good morning, Rick Burgess, Sea Power Magazine. For Admiral Shoemaker, your 10th carrier air wing is under strength for squadrons. What is your schedule to bring that back to life? Thank you.
Yeah, right now they're, I think it's in 2016 or 17. As we look into the you know, the budget negotiations and the fiscal realities and constraints that I mentioned Admiral Manazer is under right now, that's, you know, we're considering whether that's, you know, whether we can afford to do that. We've looked at the, you know, the carrier plan as we flow it out, and I think one of the reasons we even talked about that as an offset is there's I think an ability with a little bit of risk to be able to support our 11. We eventually get to 11 carriers, that rotation with 9 air wings. We've got some work to do, but you know, you consider you've got one typically in a deep overhaul, a reactor core overhaul, complex overhaul, another one in maintenance or so. I think we've got the ability to do that. So. The plan right now was to stand it up in 2017, but again, it was one of the things we looked at potentially as a cost savings measure into the very tight budget environment we're in right now.
Yes,
back here. Ricky Matsumoto, George Washington University undergrad. There was a recent report that the Pentagon recently rejected the Navy's plan to carry out Shotgun survivability tests on the second ship of the new Ford class carriers, which was expected to enter service in 2016, which might delay the first ship's deployment by at least half a year. From your perspective, are there any strategic implications or consequences of that decision, or are there any? Thank you.
Yeah, I think the memorandum that was signed by Secretary Kendall was that we would initial shock tests for Ford before her first deployment. And so that's what we're working toward, and obviously we counted her as to getting back into the mix, bring us back from 10 to 11 carriers. So we're looking at that plan right now and where that would play out in the deployment cycles. But the direction was to conduct it on Ford, and we've got that guidance and are moving out.
Yes, sir.
Hi, Chen Weihua, China Daily. I have a larger question. I think this is talk about the capabilities. I mean, the Mikhail Gorbachev just said last week, when one state has the immense military might and greater military budget than any other state, this creates an insurmountable obstacle to a nuclear-free world. I think how much should we be concerned about, you know, the talk about military capabilities? You know, we are talking about an arms race. I mean, U.S., Russia, maybe China and other countries. I mean, actually, I really want to the moderate Ambassador Prueher to talk about it. Thank you.
Did you just get a question?
I think I did. Yeah. I will, if I can paraphrase that, is how concerned should we be about the arms race and talk about arms race? I think it's something that we all need to be very concerned about, but not stampede on this subject. And that there, I just read a quotation by Thomas Jefferson recently about the peace being the delightful interlude while the factions are reloading. So this is the peace we have right now is sort of an awkward one, but with Russia, with China, with General Dunford's testimony and others on where the big threats are. I think these are things of which we need to be very cognizant and work in our country on those, but I don't think we need to stampede into an arms race. I don't see other countries doing that right now, but prevention is our business. Preventing wars is our business, and we need to be very ready to do that. So the discussions need to be taken seriously, but not stampeding on it. Yes, ma'am. in the front row.
Hi, Megan Eckstein with USNI News. General Davis, you spoke a little bit about multi-missionizing V-22. I wonder if the Navy has similar plans now that you're buying into it, and what the conversation between the two services is about coming up with a common variant for naval V-22 presence.
I think they're a little bit different right now. The Navy's going to use the airplane as a carrier onboard delivery system. Obviously, we've got a number of years operating the airplane, and we practice having weapons on it. We had Bell came out and put a sensor on there and some precision weapons. The sensor integration package, the digital interoperability for long-range communications, and now the air refueling capability. So again, Marine Corps and Navy have slightly different missions, so I'm not going to speak for the Navy, but like all stuff, you know, they'll chart their own course with the V-22.
Yeah, I totally agree, and we'll learn from the Marines and obviously partner close with them as we bring this capability into the fleet. But I think we'll end up, you know, what I've promised our cadre of COD pilots and air crew is that they'll be the ones that move into this new platform, and then it'll have some extended range. We're beefing up the range of the platform. As I mentioned, you know, it'll do the primary logistics connector for the Stryker, but we'll look at other options. You know, it brings a lot of flexibility. We've done very short demo, I guess it was two summers ago, out on the East Coast, and the air boss, the ship's opso, the flight deck were a lot still to learn about how we would integrate that. But they were pleased with how it turned out, and I think that's it'll be a great capability we deliver. But we'll continue working and partnering with the Marines as we move forward.
Okay, we'll take one last question to the patient gentleman over here with the red tie.
Thank you, James Drew from Flight Global. Could you talk to me a little bit, talk to us about the future vertical lift that the Army is working on? They've set this very far out in the future, and the companies that are currently working on that are very keen to bring that forward. Would the Navy ever, or Marine Corps, ever consider going it alone on future vertical lift? And then also maybe taking like the Valor or the Raider? And also, could you just ask me, could you just say whether you're concerned about Lockheed Martin's purchase of Sikorsky and whether that could affect any of your programs?
I'm not worried about it. As long as they produce the helicopters from the Sikorsky they're supposed to, and I've got a couple that are in the line, CH-53 Kilo, and the presidential helicopter, the VH-92. Sustain the stuff that we got, sustain the 53 Echo, sustain the H-3s and the H-60s. I have an HMX-1, totally happy. I mean, so that's business, expect them to do business, do well. If I could, shoe on the future vertical lift. Hey, we're very interested in future vertical lift, very interested in what the folks are bringing. What's really interesting about future vertical lift is it's both variants that they're looking at. It's a fly-by-wire airplane, okay, which means can be do a lot of things for us and for a Marine Corps. Can do kind of the replacement possibly for the H-1, and we look to do more and more stuff with an airplane like that, more speed, more range, more agility, looking to get much more range out of the airplane than we have right now. And then also, too, if it's fly-by-wire, it could also be unmanned. So I have a Group 4 or 5 UAS challenge out there for the United States Marine Corps, getting a Group 4 or 5 UAS onto a sea base with a fly-by-wire and high reliability. That airplane could also be, if it's got high enough reliability, it's got high enough payload capability, it could be both Group 4 or 5, it could be manned or unmanned optionally, and basically to me, if they build it the right kind of airplane, tremendous utility and tremendous agility from a platform like this. We're pretty excited about what's in store.
And we'd obviously partner with that as we come out of Romeo and Sierra, which again, I just mentioned, we delivered to the fleet, and they'll be around until easily the middle of next decade or so, but that future vertical lift will be, I think you'll see I won't say similar to how we did Joint Strike Fighter, but a joint program across all the services to see how we would deliver that capability.
Okay, on behalf of all of us, I would like to thank General Davis and Admiral Shoemaker mostly for what you do every day, but especially for being here today, and thanks so much for enlightening us all.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, all of you.